I work at Ververica. We are the original creators of Apache Flink. Probably as you have heard a couple of times. I'm Apache Flink committer, and I'm a little bit sick, so excuse me for my voice during the presentation. We'll start with quick recap how the joins work in a batch SQL. Then I will talk a little bit how they differ in streaming SQL, why I think streaming SQL is in this regard more difficult and more challenging. And after that, we will take a look how actually Flink streaming SQL tries to tackle those challenges. So let's start with joins in batch SQL. This is, I'm pretty sure that most of us are familiar with the syntax of the joins. Here we are trying to join two tables, A and B, on one simple join equality condition on ID column. Semantic is also pretty simple. Whenever we have two records that are equal, we are outputting them on the result. Like here, 1, 42, and 3. Now, how traditionally such kind of joins are executed by one of the two algorithms, sort merge join or hash join, or variation of those two. Sort merge join works in two steps. In first phase, we are gathering all of the data from both tables. Then we are sorting those tables using the join condition. And once we sorted those tables, we are performing second phase of the algorithm. Namely, we are iterating over both of them simultaneously. And whenever we find a join match, we output something on the result. Hash join works a little bit differently. Here we are first selecting one of the table, and we create a hash map out of it. So we have to read this table fully, and in our hash map, key will be the columns to use in the join condition, while the value is the row themselves. After creating this hash map, after reading fully one of the table, we can then start reading the second table record by record. And for every record, we can then perform hash lookup into our hash map. Now, why is it different in streaming SQL? Most of the differences, they boil down to a problem that in streaming SQL, queries run indefinitely. They are continuous. So we are working on unbounded inputs, and our output is also usually unbounded data stream. Let's follow a quick example. We can start with empty table A, one record in table B, so the result is also empty. Once we start processing records, like record one from table A, the result remains empty. Then we could get a record 42 from table A, which matches to something from table B. We produce something on the result, and so on. Then we could start getting records from table B, 7, 3. They didn't match with anything. Finally, we got a record from table B that matches to something, and we produce result. After processing the same kind of input as in the batch, our result is also the same. However, there are two things to note here. This query hasn't yet ended, so we are still expecting more records to come from either of the tables, and the result also can grow. Secondly, we do not have the, usually we cannot predict or we cannot enforce the order from which side the records are coming first. In batch, we could do this. Because of this, those traditional algorithms, traditional approaches, they do not work very well in streaming environment. Sort merge join is infeasible since the first phase requires to gather all of the data and sort the tables. If inputs are unbounded, we cannot sort them. In hash join, we can actually adapt this algorithm to make it work in streaming. However, the problem is the resource usage, because first problem is that since records are coming from either side of the join at the same time, we have to keep two hash maps, one for each of the side of the join. So we already are increasing our resource usage. Second problem is that our queries are working on unbounded inputs. So with hash join implementation of regular join, our resource usage memory consumption, it can grow indefinitely over time. So this is the biggest problem with regular joins, which we'll try to tackle. One of the solutions is to use the time-windowed joins. Time-windowed joins, they will be trying to use the time characteristic of the underlying data streams to limit the memory consumption. Once records, we will try to remove all the records from the state. To do so, let's do a quick recap what are the watermarks. If we have a stream of orders, if our stream might be out of order and our events might they have some assigned timestamp, as we can see on the example, 7, 11, 15, 9, 12, and so on. Then watermarks are kind of metadata that are traveling within the data, within the stream, and they are telling us what's the minimal value of the timestamp that we can expect in the future from this stream. So once we process watermark with value 11, we can assume that all of the future records, they will have value of timestamp 12 or higher. Now, how can we use this in a time window join? Let's look at another example. Here, we are trying to join two tables, orders and shipments. First, using the equality condition on order ID column. And secondly, we are defining, we are restricting the scope of the join to a time window. We are telling that we are only interested in the shipments that happened within 4 hours of the order time. Now, thanks to this time window, we can start actually removing all the records from the state without affecting the result of the join. Once we receive a watermark for order stream, then we can traverse the lower bound of the time window to this opposite stream, and we can drop all of the records from the state that are older than some certain timestamp. And vice versa, once we receive a watermark from the shipments table, a stream, we can do the same, we can prune the records from hash maps that are maintained for the order stream. So now we solve the memory consumption problem. It's restricted to something, depending on our input characteristic. However, problem is that this semantic is not suitable for every business logic. For example, sooner or later, every record will finally fall out of the time window, and it will not be able to participate in the future join matches, join results. That's why we introduced another approach to solve this problem, namely temporal table joins. To explain how do they work, let's look at another example. Here we have two tables. Rates history, which is the stream of recorded currency exchange rates, read, for example, from Kafka. So at 9 o'clock, we recorded that currency exchange rate for US dollar was 102, while later, at 11:49, we noted that US dollar was traded for 99. Second table is orders, and it's a log of transactions recorded in some foreign currencies. Like at 10:15, we recorded transaction for 2 euros. Now what we want to do is to convert the currencies from the orders to a common currency. In other words, we want to enrich the order stream with some other stream that's also evolving, is updating some values for some keys. To do so, we need to define temporal table using our rates history stream. To define temporal table, we need two things, primary key and versioning field. You can think of temporal tables as time-versioned tables that will be keeping track of changes that will happen over time for those primary keys. So once we defined temporal table from rates history stream using currency as a primary key, we will be keeping track of how the currency has have changed over the time. Now, to be compliant with ANSI SQL 2002, I think, Flink exposes temporal tables to the users via temporal table functions. So this code snippet, it will register temporal table function rates, which then user theoretically could use in the following manner. We could ask what were the values for our primary keys as of 10:15. And we would get that at 10:15, the latest exchange rates were as follows. If we ask our table function rates, what were the exchange rates as of 11:50, we would get different result. Now, how can we use this temporal table our task of converting currencies and in join? By using this simple query. Here we are scanning orders, and for every order we are asking what was the latest version of temporal table rates as of the time for this order. After obtaining this latest version, we are joining with the currency, with the matching currency, and then we are performing the actual currency conversion by simply multiplying amount from the order by our exchange rate. For example, when we will be processing order for €2, we would reach out to our temporal table and we would deduce that the latest version of the exchange rate for euro was from 9 o'clock for 114. And the result would be 228. If we later process order for €2 again, but from 11:35, temporal table join will note that the exchange rate has changed in this time, and the result will be also different. Temporal table joins also work with processing time as a side note, but this example assumes event time. So now, I hope that this was, that after this you will have some feeling how temporal table joins works, and let's sum up what we have learned so far today. And how those three ways to join the data streams, how do they compare to one another? First, we talked about regular joins. Here, we are joining all of the records from both tables with one another. And the problem here is memory consumption or resource usage, because we have to keep all of the records in the state indefinitely to have accurate results. With time window joins, we were restricting the scope of the join to a predefined static time window. Thanks to that, we were able to reduce memory consumption, and we are now only have to keep all the records between now and window length plus watermark delay. However, as I mentioned before, the problem here is that all of the records will finally fall out of this predefined static time window, and we will remove them from the state. Temporal table joins are another approach to solve the memory consumption, and they are working by also limiting the scope of the join. When we are joining two tables, table A and temporal table B, for any given record from table A, only the latest version of temporal table B is visible to it, as defined by the time from the record A. Now, thanks to this limitation, we again can limit the memory consumption, and for table A, we need only to keep all of the records between now and watermark delay, while for the temporal table, we only need to keep all versions of B between now and watermark delay. What does it mean is that if we have some primary keys that are constantly changing, like probably they would for the currency exchange rate example, we would keep multiple versions of those primary keys on the state most of the time. However, in other use cases, if some primary keys would never change, or all of them would never change, or rarely change, then we would still keep always at least one latest version of the primary key. In other words, the memory consumption of this temporal table joins in streaming SQL is very similar to memory consumption and resource usage of regular joins in batch. So thank you. That would be all from my side. I hope that after this you will understand why joins in streaming SQL are more difficult, in my opinion, and why even Flink needs to consider multiple approaches to actually how to solve them. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions? No questions? Ah, there is one. Okay.
Thank you. Great talk. Just a quick question about how the checkpoint get involved with this process. Are we able to say the event before the checkpoint or after checkpoint?
Checkpoints work completely independent of the temporal table joins or time window joins. So they work completely independent, and maybe you're, I don't know if you're asking for this, but both in time window joins and in temporal table joins, actually the results are emitted at the watermark usually.
For example, when we look at the exactly once processing, so let's say the latest checkpoint failed, and the whole streaming job lead to go back to the last successful checkpoint. So between the two checkpoints, there might be some events already get into the new temporal table. Then we might be able to see some intermediate result.
Temporal tables, table joins, and time window joins, they work using Flink internal state. So they do not violate any exactly once guarantees or at least once guarantees that you set up in your job. The only thing that might be violating exactly once if you are writing down the result of such query to something, to somewhere. If you are using exactly one thing, then like Kafka producer, then all of the exactly one guarantees will be preserved. If you are writing them to not exactly one thing, then you might get duplicated records. But as long as all of your sources and things, they provide exactly one guarantee, then whole query will also provide the same guarantee.
So when we look at the system as a whole, so that's eventually achieve the effectively exactly once. Is that correct?
Sorry, can you repeat?
I mean, so when we look at for the streaming job, and we need to look at the streaming job and the other external system as a whole. And when we look at that from the exactly once processing, that basically achieve the exactly once, I mean effectively exactly once.
Yes.
Cool, thanks.
One more question.
Oh. Hi, has there been any discussion or thinking about how to permit a join to append new fields to your stream from Elasticsearch or Cassandra or some other source-like table, but without needing to basically just do a lookup and bring that information in, but use the join semantics to do that? And
I'm not sure if I understand the question. Are you asking about like some kind of asynchronous lookup in the external database?
Right, as part of the language, instead of as a side effect or a hack that you have to do.
I don't know. Maybe Timo will know more because he's involved more with this.
So as far as I know, like there are plans to have something like an asynchronous table function, for example, so that you could potentially talk to external systems, because table functions are the perfect way of defining that in SQL, actually. Yeah. I think Blink, for example, like the Blink SQL code, they already have such a feature, like a lookup table function or something like that. Yeah.
Actually, like most of the effort with table function support for Flink was driven by Alibaba. So yeah.
I think yeah, we are running out of time, or I don't know, like maybe one more question.
How does the late arrival data will impact the join results?
The late data are currently not supported. Like they are ignored. So at the moment, that's about it.
All right. Thank you, Piotr.
Thank you.